Hello, everybody, and welcome. Welcome to the second session of today. Yeah, it's ever really good to see you all, and I can see a number of faces that I'm familiar with that have been with us as we're starting out on our magical mystery tour journey, and some new faces. So special welcome if this is your first session today. So very good to have you on board and joining our fellowship. So maybe just especially for people who are coming for the first time, I'd just like to give you a brief summary of some of the teachings and practices and exercises that we've been through so far. So we started with yesterday with a brief introduction to the theme of the retreat. And then we looked at the whole area of safety. You know, I mean, we know now, you know, with how sensitive the nervous system is to this felt sense of safety, and how we start to go offline, you know, when we start to feel unsafe and contract, and the benefits and the potential of positive, supportive community in helping us be connected with ourselves and each other. So yeah, we explored that yesterday, and then we looked at some community agreements, so some principles that can help support deepening of harmony and connection and trust in a community. And then later on yesterday, we started to turn towards our direct experience. So we were encouraged to get curious about this mysterious experience of being alive, and in particular, the felt life of our bodies. And we did some work on our chakras and seed syllables. And then this morning we continued that, we deepened into that, and we started to sense into the different dimensions of our embodied experience. So sensing for the energetic dimension of our being, the emotional side, our mental body, and then what we were calling the truth body or the Dharmakaya. So we were aiming high this morning. So if you're interested in catching up on any of some of those things, the videos will be appearing through the links that hopefully will be posted in the chat. And we have a Padlet link. So I put that down earlier as paddleboard. And I'm glad I haven't announced it as a paddleboard. So yeah, we have a Padlet link. So if you look in the text, so that this is a space, it's like a kind of community notice board where we'll post things of interest and hopefully supportive to you, and you're welcome to make comments and post things yourself. You don't have to sign up or anything. So yeah, so that's where we're up to. We're continuing this afternoon. Viveka is with us. Viveka has woken up and finished her breakfast. And her alarm clock has worked well, which is good. So she's with us here. So I'm really looking forward to this session. Well, I'm always looking forward to all the sessions, but I'm looking forward to this session as well, where we're going to start going a bit deeper into the body, and in particular, the you know, as we start to sense into the body, of course, one of the things we might meet quite strongly and quite soon is our emotional life. So this key issue in practice, you know, how do we dance creatively with our emotions to help us awaken more deeply? So we're going to be looking at different approaches to working with emotions. And then we'll have a small break, and then we'll come back into breakout rooms. So this is a chance for you to connect in a smaller context. If you don't want to be in the breakout room, then Dia Ketu is would like to know with some notice, so if you can, so if you don't want to be in a breakout room, just pop Diakato to a message, and you won't be transported into a group later. So before I hand over to Viveka, I'd just like to lead us in an arriving practice. So there's just a few minutes where we are invited to be open to our senses. And maybe now we can just open to the sense of sound around us. In a way, arriving into the essential experience of being here now. The soundscape that we're living and breathing in now, the current soundtrack to our lives. Changing life of sound. So the body is by nature sensitive. So here, just invite you to allow in the sensitivity of the body. It's like just opening that door. And allow in this cloud of sensations full of flickering sensations of life. Allowing the body to manifest experience in awareness. And feeling the soft animal of our being breathing. As we take in what we need and let go of what's no longer needed. Miracle of life. And we're all around the globe today, but we share this connection with the ground, this plane of stillness that we live our lives on. The home we share in common. However you are, whatever's alive in your being now, there's the exquisite stillness of the ground holding you, holding us. So for here, the invitation is just to gradually allow the blaze of colour and light, if you've got your eyes closed, to come in as you gradually open your eyes. And here we are together. Our fellowship of adventurers on the path. And I'll pass to Viveka now when she's ready.
Thank you. I feel like these online retreats are quite something, because We're not all sequestered somewhere, like in a space that provides like maybe some physical boundaries to the amount of and types of experiences we're having, right? So we're actually going about our days in whatever ways. And then we get to come into this supportive space together. So I know that I was just sharing with the team that I've got quite a lot of emotional content that's happened just in the last 24 hours. So the retreat, certainly the themes are very alive for me, and I'm really grateful for the increased, I feel like there's increased curiosity or like engagement with what's happening, because I have this theme about how am I, how are we, how can we be with the emotional dimension of being human, and for me, especially when it matters in relationships, you know, with myself or let's say in this case with someone I'm, people that I love, yeah? So feeling grateful to be able to be in this space with you all. Yeah, and then there's some folks that I share history with here that I'm especially like feeling that, yeah, like a hand at the back, you know, like that support of a hand at the back, just knowing there's people that care, that care for each other and yeah, want the best for each other and are like yes to each other. So just want to imagine us all like extending that a little bit to each other as we're here, knowing that we're all in the ocean of life, riding the waves, yeah. I feel you. Yeah. All right. So what we wanted to do today was really look at the Buddhist tradition and what does Buddhism offer about working with disturbing emotions, working with emotions that are strong, that we notice and then in a way feel like, okay, what do I do with this material that's arising? Yeah. So I'm going to call it it's traditionally called disturbing emotion. I mean, in the sense that it disturbs there's this homeostasis of like, oh, like there's nothing worth paying attention to. And all of a sudden it's like, whoa, there's something, there's some foment, there's some churn. Yeah. Take notice. So we're going to look at what different Buddhist approaches traditionally are to this. And I want to acknowledge that it's an amazing area of, learning, you know, there's this ancient learning, there's this very long history of learning from the Buddhist tradition, you know, just its origins, I want to say, and because there's so much erasure of the origins of Buddhism, and it's in India, you know, in the Asian homelands. So I just want to take this moment, being in an East Asian descended body, to actually appreciate the depth of those wisdom traditions that I know, like I came into just feeling it through my family culture. And then certainly, you know, all these many different strands of where humanity has been trying to work with understanding emotion and how to be with emotion. I remember also hearing especially you know, people that have survived war and like come out in, or like genocide, and like the teachings of how people survive these things. You know, there's an amazing body of work there. It's an amazing body of work from psychology and neuroscience. I just want to appreciate that's all happening. And I want to just give us a little bit of an anchor in the Buddhist map, just to see what that does for us. So well, I'll lay that out and we'll have a taster of them. And we'll just get curious about how do you tend to work with emotions? Does this spark anything for you? And when we're in small groups later, we'll get a chance to actually reflect a bit more on our, you know, how we tend to work with our emotions. Are there certain habits we have about what we tend to do when how we relate to our emotions? And we'll also have a little bit during this session, a taster of these different approaches. How you doing? Sound all right? I'm looking at my screen. Seem like human beings, yeah. Yeah, and I'm seeing a resonance with acknowledging the lineage, yeah. Many sources of our lineage in the chat. All right, so, okay, here's something. I'm gonna make a bold statement. Emotions are, yes, they noticeably are. Part of being human, I feel like a lot of Buddhism is about, wow, here we are, sensitive, experiencing human beings. How are we gonna live? How are we gonna live wisely and compassionately? What do we do with that? It's complicated, yeah. So emotions are, they're experiences that have a felt texture. We feel them, yeah. They're not abstract. Although we can learn to find names for them and begin to sort of recognize them through, let's say, being able to name and label them, which can be very helpful. Underneath those names and labels, there's this felt experience of sometimes people just say, I feel a certain kind of way. That's all that is emotion. I'm feeling a certain kind of way. And then we can get clear about that. Emotions are dynamic energies and they vibrate with different frequencies, different ways in our body, which is why some of the chakra practice we've been doing is in a way being able to just get more familiar with how energies can vibrate in our body and being with that. And emotions arise in a deeply relational way. I mean, in our inner ecosystem, they're arising in response to bodily sensations pre-consciously. Yeah. So this is like, we have evolved. This is important. You know, I can't take 5 minutes to figure out what happens when I touch a burning hot pan. You know, I need to like just, the hand needs to move away. Like, before you can snap a finger, the hand needs to be able to move away. And that's what's happening. And that's happening all the time. And there's quite a lot of that. That's just no problem. It's actually serving us quite well. Yeah. Emotions are arising and in response to bodily sensations preconsciously. And a lot of that is, it's evolved in ways to protect us from threat, to help us advance and grow. You could say achieve. So there's another category of emotions that are about enriching us. And there's like a third bucket that we could think of that are about helping us to rest and be soothed and just experience fulfillment and ease and well-being. So we just appreciate that that's part of the human legacy. And, you know, again, there's neurodiversity with that. So I'm not gonna say we experience these things in any one way. Yeah, we have different ways that emotions come to us, but that's maybe a broad stroke way of understanding what the experience of emotions contains. And then, you know, we can also, they're very deeply in relationship internally and with thoughts, right? Thoughts, like emotions and thoughts, can be like feeding off each other. So they're not just, you know, they're not just solid, right? They said they're dynamic. So they're like playing out, and they're playing out in relationship to, you know, if my body, you know, there's ways in which the body can be helped in responding to emotions. That's called, you know, in more like the Western psychology viewpoint, we might call that like regulation, like being able to be, like help regulate our emotions, help, you know, help be able to dial them up and down. So Buddhism also has this way of working with the dial in emotions. Yeah. Yeah. So all that's happening internally. And of course, it's also where emotions are happening in relationship to others, right? So like my little situation I'm working with is definitely sparked by someone else having emotions, which they get to have. Their emotions are, you know, and like that brings up like something in me, right? And then there's this like more complicated dance because it's a team of us. And then we can be in different size groups, like, you know, up to certain things that, yeah, larger groups that maybe can, like I know for myself, being in the contacts I am now, some larger groups of people, I can feel quite anxious about that dynamic, right? Let's say like larger groups of people that are, yeah, maybe there's a rise in like anti-immigrant sentiment in the US, for example, you know, like that kind of emotional feeding off each other. I can feel, this tells me why I feel it's quite important for all of us to be able to work with our emotions, right? Because it's possible for that all to like really boil up in ways that are create a kind of world that I certainly don't want to live in, but I, you know, I inherit and I'm in, so I need to find a creative response to. So I want to say that one thing I've found, it's a little pointer that's really interesting, is how surprising emotions can be. Have you ever had that, where you're just completely surprised by your, first of all, your own responses, like, wow, where did this come from? And also where other people's emotional responses come from, they can be quite surprising. Yeah. And I just want to like, sort of just allow for that. So that's also part of our situation. You know, we can, you know, I can have a story that I'm quite aware and together in a situation, and I also could just suddenly be quite surprised by what comes up. Yeah. So this is another aspect of why, you know, emotions could be disturbing, you know. So we're working with emotions specifically here in Buddhism. There's a lot of teaching around emotions that are causing some kind of churn for us. So like something's happening where it's like, oof, you know, what do I do with this? I mean, traditionally there are different lists for these. One traditional list are the five kleshas. And the word klesha means an experience that causes some kind of disturbance in the body mind. And traditionally, I'll put this in chat. We have that's my chat song. We have attachment, aversion, ignorance, pride, and jealousy. Yeah, that's the first three you find in early Buddhism, and then later Buddhism adds pride and jealousy. It's interesting to have ignorance as an emotion. You know, that might be something we get a little curious about, right? Because maybe we often think of ignorance more, I do, maybe as a cognitive kind of thing, a lack of clarity. But it's really interesting, like the feeling sense of ignorance, right? Like what's an emotion that's like cloudy, obscured? Yeah, maybe even like when we get more willfully ignorant, what's that like? Yeah. So emotions are all these, there's many other emotions. We put in the Padlet an emotions wheel. There are also a whole set of emotions that are maybe like of a different quality altogether, enlightened emotion or awake emotion, like compassion, uh, rejoicing, equanimity. There's a set of emotions that are more like from an awakened heart mind as well. And we're really talking about how do we work with the ones that can cause us suffering, yeah? So the thing is, these emotions are, again, they've evolved to help us deal with threat, to deal with growing, achieving, learning, secondly, and third, like to soothe ourselves, to be able to be in just wellness, right? All things we need. So what's important for Buddhism is how we respond to the emotions. So emotions are, they are not in themselves good or bad. They're part of the human experience. And it's how we respond with them and how you could say work with them or how we are with them, how we understand them, that is all, that makes all the difference. Yeah. So we're really talking about like, do we get sent down? Are we like skilled or not skilled with emotion would be the way. Just we're trying to get more skilled at working with disturbing emotions. And so there's this unskillful possibility, or like we lack the skills to respond creatively. So then we just create more suffering, or we get bound up in more suffering. That's one path. And the other path is of growing skill. We actually work creatively with emotion towards liberation, not just for ourselves, but for, you know, in our relational field, in our world. Yeah. So there's an unskillful path, or a path that lacks skill and the consequences of that, and the path of skill, which is a path of practice, growing skill. We become more and more creative and safer to be around. Actually, agents of positivity. So the unskillful side, I think, you know, we get to, I feel like I want to put this out without being harshly judging, like you are being unskillful. It's kind of like the predicament we're born into. It's like, there's a certain tendency that can happen unless we find a way of being more skillful with emotions. Yeah. And some of the tendencies that are perpetuate more suffering, and that's what we mean by unskillful, is a strong emotion arise and we can indulge them and act out. Yeah, we can indulge them and act out. And these like negative consequences, right? We're not being creative. The other big thing that can happen is these intense storylines build, right? Like it's, we got a novel that emerges out of a difficult emotion. And we can get really caught up in this story, and especially negative thought patterns. And we talked yesterday a little bit, the topic of blame came up, right? Blaming ourselves, blaming others. And we just go back to it, like picking that scab, which we know isn't that helpful, but we just can't help it, yeah? So that's the other thing that happens to human beings. When we're in this unskillful path, there's a distortion of our relationships. So we are misconstruing what's happening in the present based on fears that come out of our past history. Yeah. So there's like a distortion in the relational field. The other thing is this battle energy comes up. I'm in a battle with my emotions. Yeah, so then the general field is one of contraction or being in a fight. Or, you know, we might be like suppressing or like really having to numb ourselves, which to some degree can be provisionally necessary and skillful. I want to say some of that could be skillful, but there can be a level where it's like, if we're just always suppressing our emotions, it becomes like, it can perpetuate. It's like a lack of skill with ourselves of knowing how to be with our emotions, right? So there's some healthy compartmentalization, but then if our signature move is just to suppress all the time and we're generally just deadening ourselves, and that's like, what's the skill we need to be able to be in a more feeling alive, embodied way? Yeah. So that's the unskillful, like a lack of skill, and that these things all don't really tend to give us a more creative life. And our presence in the world, you know, it has consequences in the relational field. You know, causes, it's kind of got a knock-on effect. Other bodies start to have more afflicting emotions as in relationship to this. Yeah. And on the skillful end, where there's this training in the ability to just be with emotions, with a range and more the range of emotions, not only in ourselves, but in others. So that's a gradual training. How can we be with more and more of the vibrational frequencies of the possibility of human emotions? Buddhism says 84,000 emotions, like just 84,000 is like a huge list. I actually saw a Western psychological list that said 34,000, which made me laugh because it was just like categorizing, wow, it's like 34,000 and 84,000. It just sounded like a real resonance, but you know, many. So how can we be with those without having like a lot of no-go zones where we're bypassing, basically? You might've heard this tone, like can't go there. Nope, can't do that, can't do that. So there's just like, imagine being able to be with, all right, yes, okay, all right, and this, yeah. But being with it in a way where we have some perspective, yeah, we're not over. So the overwhelm of the unskillful isn't happening. We can be with it in a centered kind of way, yeah. Present here. Yeah, with a larger perspective. It's the emotion is not the only thing that's happening. We can see that there's this energy passing through. We can experience an energy passing through, and we have access to a larger perspective, a larger space of awareness. Emotions then, all the emotions become portals to compassion. So this is why I think it's especially powerful when there's not good emotions and bad emotions, right? Some, all emotions become portals to compassion. Like we really like, and empathy, like, yeah, that happens. That happens. That can happen. You know, there can be extreme distress. There can be extreme anger. There can be grief. There can be this repulsion, all this. Yeah. There can be jealousy. Yes. And there's a bit more of a soft, like a softening, like creative response. So we get more real, you know, it saves us from being like, oh, like the superficiality of being a good person. Like, no, I don't experience hate. Because I'm a Buddhist. Really? Is that true? Yeah. Yeah. So with that freedom, we begin to be able to express compassion and non-harm, actual creative love in the world. And also wisdom becomes available. Yeah. So we're going to talk about how that all happens. But importantly, the wisdom becomes available. So it's not just that we're coping. But I'd say the Buddhist version of thriving is that we're actually, is a dimension called wisdom, you know, which is totally linked to compassion, where we actually are so real. We're able to be with the reality of emotions and the reality of experiencing and the reality of the nature of experience, that there's no, we're not in opposition with how things are. Yeah, there's a flow. And even like you could say, one of the Vajrayana images is being like the magician, being the magician rather than being fooled by all the magic tricks. Yeah. All right, how are we doing? See this? Yeah. I see a thumbs up from Elizabeth. Hi, Elizabeth. Thanks for that. Hi, all the way in New Zealand. We see you. Big love. I see you, Liz. The Oakland hoodie. all right, so we're gonna try a few of these, okay? So now, what are the classic Buddhist ways of approaching this then? And this, we're in this situation. So there's three, we're gonna look at three approaches. And maybe Singhatri, you could chat the headers of these just so people have a reference, yeah? So the first is going to be a mindfulness approach, which is letting it be. So for shorthand, we're going to call that let it be. Will I sing what you obviously might be thinking of? Let it be. Let it be. No, I won't. Okay, mindfulness, let it be. The second one is about applying antidotes, like a more medicinal approach. So we're doing something to the experience, trying to do that creatively. So we're calling that two, doing two as a shorthand. And the last one is really a deeper engagement with the emotion. So not only are we mindful of and have the choice of being able to do something to help us be with the emotion. This is like going, really going more deeply into that felt experience. And we're calling that with. Yeah. So mindfulness is maybe the best known. We're in the middle of this dynamic experience. Balajit led us in beautifully to it, to something we call mindfulness. And that not trying to stop that dynamic flow of experience, but we actually intentionally come in to evoke a space of awareness, right? So we create a space by remembering awareness. And then we're like, rather than it just all happening, we're actually, the ability to observe and notice and give attention to what happens comes in. And so that's the act of mindfulness. So we're rather than doing all the reacting, because when we're feeling a certain kind of way, right, there's impulses to act, there's thought chains that start happening as we described. So we're just being with it. So we're not fueling the unskillful, we're just being with it, and we're experiencing without, we're explicitly saying there's nothing I'm fixing or doing right now. We're sort of refraining from taking action other than being aware. Yeah. So it's kind of like a harm prevention thing going on here. We're just letting it be. And it's like giving ourselves a space to notice. Yeah. And in this, we can free up some of that unskillful secondary emotions and reactions that happen. We're getting a little non-identified with what's happening. It's not like everything that's happening is like me. There's kind of a space around that, right? So there's like, it's not all me. This feeling is not me in its entirety. It's happening. Something's happening. You know, like there's a broader sense of capacity to be aware rather than it just all being all consuming. So the superpower of this approach is that we shift from just being in chains of reactivity to space for creativity. And this non-identification, yeah. Okay, so something to be mindful of when being mindful is that in being observing that we're not cutting off feeling. I think that's a certain thing. Sometimes mindfulness with the way we're being mindful, we actually sort of skip including the feeling body. Yeah, so like if you're doing like labeling or sometimes there can be a little bit of a, like a script of what's going on. Just, there's this thing about, and we'll be doing a lot of just making sure we're actually in the feeling body. We're actually feeling versus, in the thinking head and, leaving the feeling body. Yeah. So we get this expression, be like a block of wood sometimes that Singer Tree's put in chat. And I feel like that maybe the metaphor of that traditionally is like about block of wood doesn't jump around. It's more about that. Like a block of wood's not like, it's like, don't be like a block of wood that's being thrown at somebody. Like, it's just like, just be there. But it doesn't mean, I want to really caution us. It doesn't mean be unfeeling and inanimate. That's not what that metaphor means, right? So just to be careful, like about in our skill of mindfulness that we're actually really opening to not only observing, but actually inhabiting our lives too. So it's the both and. It's not like it's happening to someone else. It's like the most intimate experience there is. And by being intimate with the experience, because it's happening right here in this ecosystem, our interiority. By that, it's like this tremendous opportunity to learn about empathy and compassion. If we can't be with what's right here, it's very hard to be with anybody else's emotions, to be with the expression of the world, if we can't be with this expression. Yeah. So let's just try it for a moment. Like, we're going to do a micro version of mindfulness. Yeah. And let me just ask you to go to, we're going to just remember, look, just take a moment to put down paper or pens. I'm just going to invite you to scan for where there might be something that feels a bit more tender in the emotional field. Maybe it's just like a relationship that might be in a little disharmony, or maybe something you've done where you're still feeling a certain kind of way about it, like you're not settled with yourself about it. Maybe you feel a little bit of regret or even shame. So just notice what might feel a little tender in your experience. If you're mad about something. So we're not going for level 10 activation, but just something that gives a little sense of activation. And just around that, maybe you have to remember a situation to recall that feeling. Just notice the sensations in the body that come with that. Find some awareness, maybe being anchored in the breath. We're not swept away. So what's the vibration or feeling tone in the body that might come with this unsettledness? Just feeling that. Pressure, tingling, flow, color. For now, not having to fix it or do anything, but just feeling that protection of just the space of awareness. Like the very fact that you're not doing anything gives you protection to just be here a little more. You don't have to fear yourself right now doing something. Notice what might want to soften in the body. Deeper breath. I'm just curious, are there any particular thoughts that want to assert themselves? And we don't have to stop them, but there's a subtlety of not fueling them. So there can actually be like a kind, like, yeah, there you are, if they're there. In a way, that kindness just lets them roll without having to throw gasoline on it or build more. So what might that be like? Deep breath as we need it. As we check in with our breath, we notice if we're holding our breath, which might be a clue somewhere, shutting off or bypassing in the body, and just being curious about that. We don't have to force ourselves to feel anything, but we just notice, oh yeah, something maybe doesn't want this experience. Just being kind with that. Or if it's the obvious, if it's the opposite and we're getting pulled right in, we can notice, oh yeah, some part of us really wants to build on this experience, being kind with that. Okay, and before we end, we'll use the support of our environment. So we'll just, if your eyes have been closed, you can open them and just notice the space of the room. They're open, you can just notice the space of the room around you. So you can notice that there's something else other than this emotion. The emotion is not the whole of you. I can see, like you can name and experience five objects, maybe experience a color or shape. So for example, green chair, feeling the greenness. Just have a look around. Non-identification, the emotion's not me. It is happening, but it's not all of me. Maybe it's changed from the beginning of this little exercise to now. Just notice what's happening now. All right, so that was a mindfulness taster. You're going to have a chance in small groups to actually check in about that. I'm going to keep rolling in the interest of getting you to small groups. Yeah? Are we okay with doing a taster of the next one? Okay. So what's the next one? Does anyone remember? Someone unmute.
Antidote.
Yay, thank you. Antidote, doing something too. And this is meant to be in a creative way. Yeah. So this, how do we do this? We might cultivate the opposite of something, or more like a healing, like come to it with a healing. So we're tending to it. You know, maybe it's maybe tending to is a better word than doing something to it, which might sound a bit hostile if we're tending to. So for example, if you're anxious or agitated, you know, what are practices that help you access stability? Right. So we here, when we come here, we're coming a lot of the activities we do, the exercises are finding ground, finding earth as a stabilizing on the retreat. Sometimes breath meditation is used. Some of us find that meditating on the breath causes more agitation. So then like just actually feeling contact with the earth, feeling our senses, you know, your hearing sense could be more helpful. Yeah, that's one example, classic example. Another example, you know, you're being disturbed by obsessive thoughts of like, let's say it's pride. Let's say you feel wrong in some way and you have a lot of like, I can't believe they said this. And, you know, classic, oh, the next time I see them, this is what I'm going to say, right? Like just all those pride kind of obsessive thought chains. With that, we can expand the awareness. So there's like this obsession wheel. It's okay, that's happening. So how do we tend to that? It's like we give ourselves a break. We notice something else, you know, purposeful distraction could be an antidote. Let me think about something else. Let me do a mantra. Let me chant. That takes the thought energy. Yeah. Help that thought energy. For example, if you are angry with someone, with yourself, perhaps, with a situation, cultivating patience, you might reflect on, well, what are some of the conditions at play here? Yes, this is very unsatisfactory, but it's not like it didn't come out of nowhere, you know, like there's conditions, right? Yeah, if you're feeling a lot of jealousy, you could cultivate rejoicing. I'm going to put a little list in chat for you. Classic list. And actually, there's an article. So I will list in chat and in the Padlet. I'm also going to put an article with Tipton Chodron, who has a great list of these, but I found it very helpful. But you get the idea. You're like, it's like either balancing something or like taking it something that's like really dominating our attention and taking over and like widening out. Or there could be some pacifying of something. Yeah. Soothing of something. We're anxious, soothing. So tending to. So Let's take an example of this, and let's take the one I find like where we might be feeling a bit of pride about something. Um, let's say something we feel good about. But maybe, sometimes we can feel insecure about feeling good about something. So feeling pride can be like a little bit complicated. I've heard it said that in British culture, it can be very complicated. There's a lot of you in Britain. I've heard it said, this is a rumor, horrible rumor. The feeling, just feeling good about an accomplishment can be a little bit complicated. Like culturally, pride is like, don't go there. Yeah. So I want us to actually remember something we actually feel good about and help us liberate pride as potentially a problem by reflecting on indebtedness. This is what this is. So what that means is reflecting on all the conditions that made that possible. So in a way, like it actually, rather than pride isolating us from others and it feeling like dangerous, it's like a version of a positive, like it's a positive antidoting of like, oh, we could actually get into a terrain of this emotion that's more skillful by actually having it connect us. Yeah. So you can do this by writing. I'll give you a couple of minutes or just imagining, visualizing. So I'll give you an example. I'm feeling really good about a space that was held last week. I train with this institute called Rockwood Leadership Institute for Social Justice Leaders. And we were able to hold a space for women of color and femme leaders. And it went really, really well. And I feel a lot of pride. So I'm going to just take a little time to really notice the conditions that came together, that it was not just me acting alone. How did I learn how to hold that space? Who was I holding space with? So you can have your own example. Let's just take a couple minutes. What were the conditions that made that all possible for you to feel good about something you were part of? Okay, and as you would like, maybe you could chat what you notice, what effect does doing this have on you? You know, on your mood, on your quality of being. Anybody wants to chat? So it's an antidote to pride being afflictive, yeah? So you can chat if there's what you notice, how reflecting on our indebtedness, or we could say gratitude related to this accomplishment affects us. Yeah. Angela saying it brought in a sense of expansion to my experience. All right. Feeling more connected and appreciating support I had. Gratitude, spacious. Yeah, so pride can be emotion. We can have, oh, be careful, pride. There might be fear very close to pride. Yeah, so it's in a way, it's like, how can we work with that kind of emotion, right? One of the main group of five disturbing emotions. Oh, and there's a, like some bittersweetness of like, oh, maybe coming out of not realizing, yeah, for more the conditions someone has created for us. Yeah, so I hear that connectedness. Soft, warm, expansive. Yeah. This is just one example of antidoting. Some that might be afflictive. Yeah. Shifting towards the skillful. Gratitude to others, possibility, broader perspective. Yeah. Just noticing how our own bodies start to respond. I notice I'm having like this skill, these people doing their work with emotions, tending, noticing what effect that has on your body. I'm feeling, as I read this, yeah, I'm getting softer. I'm like more possibility. All the things are starting to happen. It's like a virtuous cycle.
Yeah.
Expanding. Grounded, stabilizing feeling of celebration. More like compassion than acquisitive. Yeah. Realizing I couldn't have done this without the other person, softening in my chest. Yeah. So that's an example of antidoting, and also an example of how powerful it is just to be working with our emotions. It has this, it creates a culture, right? This is how we actually change our world. Like our world just changed right now in the last 5 minutes, our entire world just changed. A different energy stream went into our world from the practice you've been doing. All right, so last one, we'll do a taste for the last one and then we'll have time for groups. So one thing I want to say about antidoting, actually, so the superpower is what we're experiencing. It, the soothing, healing, being able to find our agency is so important. Like, oh, I can do something here. Right? I actually have creativity with my emotions. I'm not just like stuck with them. Yeah. And I think there is this kryptonite. So all these approaches have their superpower and their kryptonite, right? The kryptonite or the near enemy would be if we get into over-managing our experience. Yeah. So if we're always feeling like I have to do something to the experience and make it better, quote, better, we can fall into like a kind of spiritual materialism, always trying to make experience better or doing something to it. I love this thing that Balajit said yesterday about like as something as simple as coming to meditation. Like, oh, I'm here to meditate. And we can sort of immediately, without even realizing we're doing it, it's possible that we might just impose a sense of calm on our experience, regardless of what our experience actually is. And just be like, I'm meditating, I'm supposed to be calm. So we're kind of over-managing ourselves. And then it's like, are all we allowing is calmness? Are we not allowing for the fuller range of what actually is, which is, a, you know, we don't want to lose our mindfulness and antidoting to the fuller experience, yeah? So we want to antidote as helpful, but we don't want that to block the somatic competency of being able to be with many, many different energy frequencies, right? So we don't want it to end up being intolerance or fragility, if that makes sense. This is happening, have to antidote it. This is happening, have to antidote it, yeah? All right, so the very last one in a way is the simplest, but maybe perhaps the one that we can feel like, oh, really, am I gonna do that? Which is more deeply engaging with what's happening. Yeah, and it's kind of like from, I feel like it's a natural portal from mindfulness practice. Yeah, mindfulness practice, we create this space where we're aware of experience, we're actually able to, you know, with training, we can feel what's happening and not react. So we could be disinterested. That's even a word that's used positively sometimes. It's just a flow. But in a way, there's maybe there's something else that's possible. Through deeper engagement. So what happens if we go through the portal of deeper engagement? Yeah. So there's a different kind of superpower benefit here. So this means actually turning towards the energetic experience itself, feeling more deeply the feels. With that perspective, we like almost mature the whole mindfulness experience. So the space of awareness is there and we feel more like we're getting more intimate. So in a way we're coming out of the observer seat. If there's any kind of like, I don't know, like at the beach, sometimes the lifeguard sits in their own little hut and they're watching the ocean, right? Very attentive. We're coming out of the lifeguard hut and going right into the ocean. We are like, in a way we are just the ocean. All we are is this space of awareness and these various energetic frequencies coming through. Yeah, and I think some of the ways that, for example, Eve, the way Balajit led the arriving practice, it's simple, that's there. That's potentially there just in the way it was being led. And the thing is, so sometimes it's said like our energy is just like the ocean's waves. There's the experience rising. It's just the waves just are, but there's also that whole, the whole ocean. There's also the larger field of stability always there. The waves are none other than the ocean. That's the metaphor. We go from being a block of wood to the ocean, the dynamic, so much more dynamic, all the ocean's waves and the space of the ocean itself. And the vividness of these disturbing emotions. So then the fact that we're being disturbed by emotions becomes like such a, it's considered like the teacher, the benefit of the practice. There, it's considered the path versus something to try to get over. If only I weren't feeling disturbing emotion, I could meditate. If only I weren't feeling disturbing emotion, I could wake up. We actually shift that to, I'm so vividly here. This is so vivid. These sensations. Yeah. And so then in the vividness, we get to see we penetrate deeper and deeper to what's this experience and being it, not just like observing it and labeling it, actually being it, which is different than identifying because it's all dynamic. There's nothing to hold on to. It's ungraspable experience. It is an introduction to what in Buddhism is considered like an ultimate reality perspective, wisdom. All we can say is there's a space that's always there, the larger space, and these energies shimmering, dancing, contradictory, simultaneous, total, beyond inside or outside. You know, when someone wrote in the chat what happened and there was like a shimmering over here, what was inside, what was outside, yeah. So that, just as it is, the deepest as it is, it's the deepest as it is, unconditionally being with, not leaving our world, not leaving our experience, deeply present. So, you know, in Buddhist speak, this is the truth of shunyata. Now, the space of ungraspability and everything, all the potentiality, the infinite potentiality, you know, the surprising emotion, get a load of this, get a load of that, get a load of this. And in the Tibetan world, there's this expression, ema ho, which I love because it's just like this expression, like, get a load of this, just like, wow, yeah. So at that deepest level, we can actually harness these energies rather than like trying to manage them. We're really moving away from managing and we actually like, we get to reclaim these energies, our full aliveness, yeah? And we get at the root, we don't need to fear anything that can arise anymore. Ah, yeah? The kryptonite would be if we lose that perspective, the wisdom, the perspective, yeah? So we end up indulging emotion. So we get caught up again and we're just indulging, yeah? And getting lost in it or getting overwhelmed or maybe romanticizing or reifying the emotion. So we start identifying with it. We get intoxicated with the emotion. And these all tend to have negative consequences, right? That we start to, the impact on our relational field really starts to suffer. Yeah, people can lose trust in us. Yeah, we're not having the width of being aware of how we're impacting others. Yeah. Yeah, like if we're just letting off steam, may not actually have perspective, and we may not have the perspective of how am I impacting others. Okay, so that's the last one. The last way is the deeper engagement. I feel like we'll just do a short practice and go from here and go to break. If we could do, would people be okay with a 10-minute break? Would that be okay? All right. So we'll do a short practice of this. We'll go to a break, and then Singishi will help get us into groups, yeah? Okay, so for the short practice of this, we can just put down anything we're writing with, or even release a screen. Have to look at the screen. If you want, you can close your eyes, or you can let your eyes gaze into a soft horizon. And we're just gonna notice where there's some aliveness we can come in contact with in the body. So where in the body are there energies that are making themselves known to us? Be a little shimmer, tingling, pressure. And for a moment, we're going to recollect a time when we got irritated, and it was enough heat that we felt it. You know, it's like something. We're like, oh, it was a little bit of a making itself known. Yeah. So for skillful reasons, we're going to recollect something again that had some irritation to it, and really, rather than trying to manage those feelings in the boundaries of this practice, we're going to really actually encourage those feelings to express. So just noticing what happens to you when you hear those words, or when someone is in a certain posture towards you, yeah, or when life conditions are not cooperating, whatever it is in your situation. And just really let yourself, in a way, like, let those feelings come closer. So if there's any sense of warding them off, and we're really relating to the energetic quality. So there might be story happening. How would you describe that, or feel that energetic quality of irritation, anger? And noticing, getting subtle enough to notice the dynamic quality. So the subtle fluctuations. It's almost like watching a fire, being the fire, yeah. Flickering. In a way, there's something released. Yeah, when to feel deeply this way, we have to, in a way, release the constructions we make, the fabrications, the story, the us versus them, go deeper into just the raw, direct sensation in the space of awareness. All these energies are just like the ocean's waves. No need to stop them. Coming and going. And what if we are in the condition of the waves where we're just being tossed around? Remembering what that can be like. Just bossed around by our irritation. Just imagining dropping down or getting more expansive to be the ocean. Dropping down further into the feeling body, the sensing. So rather than just being in the surface of the waves, we are the whole ocean. Dropping down, dropping wider. Last thing that we'll do is on the count of three, we'll just try dropping a little deeper. One, two, three. Okay. Maybe not having to leave that space of awareness, that expansiveness, but rather than tending to any particular experience, just coming back to the context of the room, being here. Notice how you do that. Maybe notice if there's a tendency to contract when you do that, and what would it be like to allow for the sense of spacious awareness to come with you. So the teaching here is it's always there. That spacious awareness is always there if we remember it. Yeah. And those waves of experience are already self-antidoting. They come and go, they shimmer. There's nothing solid at its deepest level, nothing menacing. We don't need to iron the ocean's waves.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was amazing. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, well.